So, we had just wrapped up our last full day at Swing Arm City, and with the weather report not being in our favor, we decided to squeeze one last flight in that morning before packing things up. We all organized our wings on the Hanksville airstrip and blasted off towards Goblin Valley, which was about 10 miles away. Storms were evident off in the distance, and the air wasn't as inviting as we'd hoped it would be. But the geology here was diverse, and it ended up being a fun cross-country flight, even if only a couple of us got to go hoodoo swooping with the goblins. When it rains, it pours. I barely got my camping stuff packed and the four-wheeler loaded before it started raining cats and dogs. I mudded my way back to the highway, and by the time I got there, there was so much hail on the ground, it looked like it had just snowed an inch. I had never experienced flash floods like this, and after a nice cruise to Moab, I decided to book a hotel and catch up on some much-needed sleep. At this point, it was just Rob and I. We were loaded to the brim with off-road toys and all the gear necessary to take on the adventure capital of the world.
Go time?
I'm no stranger to Moab, but somehow, some way, the wind gods always cooperate and give me the best possible conditions when I fly here, which just happens to be the most challenging conditions for launching a small glider out of a trailhead parking lot. These conditions are necessary for flights like this, and I'm glad I got to be there for Rob's first flight through the Arch, the epitome of paramotor bucket list flights. After we'd made a few passes through Corona Arch and determined the air was absolutely prime for flying, I couldn't resist the urge to follow the mesmerizing train tracks for a ways, before remembering this cool arch I'd hiked to once upon a time. This was Jeep Arch. It wasn't quite big enough to squeeze through, but it was still a crazy perspective looking through the literal hole in the rock and seeing Rob carving it up on the other side. Personally, I can't think of a better way to explore the desert. I spotted a ton of other arches, a cool train tunnel, and we seen Moab covered in an eerie layer of fog before coming into land. Operation Corona Arch went off without a hitch. Once we debriefed in the parking lot, we decided to hike the tracks to the train tunnel, following it for a few miles into the pitch black abyss. Then Rob whipped up some of his famous van case ideas, and I decided to head back into Moab to let people know I was still alive. I did a bunch of one-wheel exploration that afternoon and prepped for the next insane flight we were about to take on later that evening. Before I knew it, I was strapped in and ready to run back into the sky. I did what we do, and couldn't wait to buzz through this canyon our good pal Kevin told us about. I was excited to explore some new uncharted territory, at least to me, and I even ran into this random paraglider that seemingly came out of nowhere. I probably just disrupted his peace, but coming from Kansas, I'd never seen a paraglider in the wild before, so I was fascinated. Continuing onwards to the canyon, we didn't waste any time finding the good stuff. That's one thing that just blows my mind about Utah. A ton of rock formations and canyons out here don't even have names. Meanwhile, back in Kansas, one reddish-colored rock would undoubtedly become the staple of Kansas. These things just don't exist where I come from, making flights like this easy to appreciate. When you go in blind, with no expectations, you're setting yourself up for success. We definitely didn't expect to buzz past these cool caves, which were among plenty of other lost and forgotten objects dwelling within the tree-infested canyon. It's a pretty rare treat to just drop down into a canyon and safely get up close to the massive rock walls, but I'd say we made the most of it. This canyon seemed to never end. We got to a larger opening, and I felt like we just stumbled upon this scene from Jurassic Park, if there were dinosaurs on Mars, that is. As it started to get dark on us, I noticed about the only thing Utah and Kansas have in common is the knuckle-numbing cold weather in the fall, which means I had to save my water foot drags for the end of the flight to avoid hypothermia. Paramotoring has to be the best water sport out there, and this chilly ski session on Kins Lake surely froze this flight as one of my personal all-time favorites. With my landing gear frozen solid, it's slightly amazing that I was able to nail a downwind landing. But with post-flight beer and a warm meal to keep us motivated, we both made it look easy.
That's spicy. That was exactly like my landing. That was great. So, what'd you think? That was insane. Yeah, same here. Did you see mine?
I guess we sort of had a tailwind.
We did.
At the crack of dawn, we checked the wind forecasts and determined the Corona Arch area was the best spot to fly that morning. By now, you guys know the routine.
Oh, yeah. So cool. My turn. Hello, how are you?
It might seem a bit silly to drive halfway across the country and fly the same spot more than once, but that's just not the case with this place. It has its reputation for a reason. Some spots require plenty of respect while you're getting to know them, and once you're well acquainted, it's time to loosen up and have some fun. Threading the needle at Corona Arch simply did not and will not ever get old. There wasn't a twitch in the air, so we ventured down some trails that only Jeeps are supposed to see. This might have been the same area as the previous morning's flight, but every aspect was different this time. Over every rock and around every bend, it seemed like we unlocked a whole new world to discover. But I guess that's just the magic of Moab. I've spent weeks exploring this area and feel like I've barely scratched the surface. I usually show up with a rough itinerary of what I want to do, but the deeper I dig, the more I find, and the to-do list just continues to grow. Refrigerators, we got some movies, color TV. I went for a flight down memory lane as I passed this cool cave me and some guys scrambled into last winter, and all the good times from that trip instantly came flooding back. Between the potash ponds and discovering even more new arches, I think this is what every paramotor pilot's dreams are made of. And just for good measure, we decided to buzz the arch a few more times. A lot of this footage came from a family that I ran into at the trailhead after landing. Seeing people react to paramotors for the first time is always priceless. And it feels kind of good knowing we made even just the smallest part of someone's day. I did a little practice foot dragging the tracks before we stacked our paramotors in the canyon. I had maybe a couple spare feet on either side of my wingtips, but the Piper handles like it's on rails. Pun intended. This flight was an absolute blast from start to finish. I'd say we had maximum fun as far as the arch goes. And although I was almost out of dry socks, I still managed to do my celebratory Colorado River foot drag before calling it a morning. We could have soared through the arch all day, but I was eager to whip out the four-wheeler on some of that famous Moab slick rock that afternoon. We split up that morning, and I decided I'd see if I could adventure out to the caves we flew past the night before. It was a really cool canyon ride, crossing streams and bouncing over boulders until I was face to face with the three windows of the cave. It's funny how when I'm on the ground, I'm always dreaming up interesting places to fly. And when I'm flying, I'm always finding cool things to do back on the ground. After a little spelunking fun, I met Rob up on Sand Flats Recreational Area, where we found ourselves on some of the coolest trails I've ever seen. It really doesn't matter what outdoor hobby you're into. Moab has something to offer for everyone. I've been to this area numerous times, and bringing a four-wheeler along just unlocked 1,000 new trails. We rode all the way to the Porcupine Rim, where we got this insane overlook of Castle Valley, before heading back for our final flight in Moab.
There we go.
If you thought we'd be tired of flying by now, well, let's just say we were just getting warmed up. I guess our friend Kevin was jealous of our canyon run from the night before and wanted to meet us back at that LZ. The canyon was phenomenal, but I had some special plans of my own for this flight. At this point in the trip, Rob and I had been flying together quite a bit, and we started picking up on each other's flying styles, making it easy to anticipate each other's next move. And that's when flying really starts to get fun. We dipped back down into the canyon and quickly noticed it wasn't quite as smooth as last time. We pushed onwards through the canyon for a ways before I decided to bail out for a little side quest of my own. After flying past Kins Lake one more time, I got to thinking about the random orange paraglider that floated past me the night before. I wondered where he launched from, and if there was enough wind, could I top land on the ridge where he took off from? It seemed rather ambitious, but hey, everything else had gone smooth so far, so why not give myself a challenge? And that's when I floated past the perfect ridge to land on. I made a low pass and did a quick touch and go to assess the wind direction and determine whether this was a terrible idea or not. The air was cold and bumpy, but it was out of the perfect direction to land and take back off. Everything in my bones was telling me I needed to do this, so I listened.
This is amazing.
So yeah, I just landed out on top of this ridge. Took off way down there in the airport. Texted Rob, he's on his way.
This is crazy. Moab, you never disappoint.
This is beyond amazing. Man, the last week I've been going so fast paced, and it's like I haven't just like stopped to take it all in. It's all going so fast, so much is happening. I haven't processed the last week. And to just land up here and take it all in all by myself, it's truly surreal. But it's getting kind of dark, so I think I'll probably head back. How did I get so lucky?
I sat up there for quite a while, just in absolute awe, trying to wrap my head around the fact that this somehow gets to be my life. Every decision I'd ever made eventually added up to this very moment up on a mountain. And all there was left to do was run back into the sky. I flew back to the LZ, filled to the brim with gratitude. I soaked up the last sliver of sunlight and blasted some Skynyrd, because this Moab party was almost over. It's crazy, really, how 1 second you're standing high up on a ridge, and minutes later, you're swooping in next to your nice cozy F-150. There's something special about Moab. This was just one guy's story. Moab has created 1,000 stories for 1,000 other paramotor pilots. And I have a good feeling this story won't be my last.